Micah 4, verses 6 through 13. If you've been studying with us, we have been walking through the book of Micah. We stopped last week in chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. We're picking back up now in verses 6 through 13. So if you're here for this first time, like all of us that started out, go to your table of contents, look in the Old Testament, find the book of Micah. It's kind of in the latter part of the Old Testament. And then you'll find that book, and we'll be in chapter 4, verses 6 through 13, okay? This is where we're going to be today. While you're turning there, I have some supporting passages that I want to give you to look at, because we will not have notes on the screen today, so let me get on my phone real quick. Okay, Micah 4. Take that back in. Micah 4, verses 6 through 13 is where we're going to be today, okay? We're going to refer to and look at some other passages. Here are the passages. Psalms, we got six passages. Psalms 106, 6 through 12. Psalms 106, 6 through 12. Now, they'll put the scripture on the screen, but if you want to write them down in your notes, Psalms 106, 6 through 12. Proverbs chapter 3, 11 through 26. Proverbs 3, 11 through 26. Next two passages are out of Jeremiah. Jeremiah 29, verses 10 through 14. Jeremiah 29, 10 through 14, and Jeremiah 31, 31 through 37. I mean, I wish we could just read that whole 29, 30, and 31. That's some good stuff, but 31, 31 through 37, where we're going to focus on. It's 29 and 31. Then the fifth passage, Psalms 33, 6 through 22. And then Revelation chapter 22. Psalms 33, 6 through 22. Revelation 22. All right. Okay. Before we get started, I did this in the first service, and so I want to do this with you guys. I want to get our mind a little moving this morning, and I want you to think about some scenarios with me today. And the theme of the scenarios is to focus on the limitations and futility of man, okay? The limitations and the futility of man. And the first area we're going to look at is the limitations and futility of a man's plans, okay? So the first scenario guides us towards his plans and what a man sets out to do and how limited in his own power and how futile sometimes in his own efforts he goes about trying to accomplish his plans. So yesterday there was probably this guy who Friday night before sat down in his lazy boy and started thinking through what he was going to do the next morning. He had done a good day's of work, and if he's like me, he wants to do something that's therapeutical. He wants to do something that he can do and be done with it, do a project, see the work of it, be done. Sometimes guys like me in our line of work, we don't get to see a finished product all the time. And so for me, it's therapeutic to ride a lawnmower. Amen? Because you can get going and you can cut the grass and you can be done with it. And that's just, there's something crazy about that enjoyment, okay? But it's like it's there. So this guy has this same sense. So he wakes up in the morning, has a good night rest, and wakes up, eats some breakfast, goes out to mow his grass. He gets around the first round in his yard, looking nice and clean, getting that last cut before the frostbite comes and makes the grass brown, making sure everything's clean, and then his belt breaks on his lawnmower. His whole plan, see, somebody's already patting somebody in the room today, okay? His whole plan was to knock this out before lunchtime so he could eat a good meal and then enjoy some football games that afternoon, okay? But now what has happened is the belt is broke. He's got to figure out how to get that lawnmower on the trailer to a shop before they close at noon, because no shops stay open anymore after noon, you know, for lawnmowers, okay? And he's hoping that they can do something so that he can get back in time. But the reality is, he's not going to get the yard cut before lunchtime. So his plans are futile, and his power is limited, okay? Well, let's move on from that. Let's go to a man's purpose in life, okay? The limitations and the futility in that. Yesterday morning, some man woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning, put on clothes that smell like pee, walked out in the cool of the day, got in a truck with his buddies, and he went and climbed a tree so that he could slay a deer with his gun, come back home and be known as the great hunter. I have provided food for my squaw and my children. I have cleaned that deer. I have now put the meat in the cooler, and I have fulfilled my purpose in life. The futility and the limitation on that is that his next door neighbor slept till 9 o'clock that morning. Got up, drank his cup of coffee in the comfort of his lazy boy instead of a tree climber. Then decided at 10 a.m. to go to the meat market. And instead of spending all that money on bullets and guns and a license, he went and got the steak the way he wanted it because it was cut up for him already. And he was able to grill that steak at lunchtime while the other guy's meat still sits in the cooler, okay? And so the hunter's purpose in life did not go beyond his own little world, because the next door neighbor said, man, I just did a shortcut of that process and got to the same point, eat the food, and I've done it. Well, let's move on from that. Let's go to something like maybe our pride of our passions that we love. Yesterday, somebody got up and they didn't go mow the grass and they didn't go climb a tree. They went to a ball game somewhere nearby, stayed away maybe. They drove 4 or 5 hours to get there. They spent $100 for the ticket. They spent $100 for the experience. But they spent a lot more money getting there and getting back. Also that for 4 hours they could see their team get slaughtered by another team. Okay? And so their pride and their passion going down the tank. They come home with their head down, thinking, man, I could have saw this loss on TV and been home already, you know? And I could have spent that money in some other way. Because what experience was there without the win? But there could have been another guy that was in different colors that day that did the same amount of energy and effort, and he walked away feeling like it was one of the greatest days of his life. But yet, even in his triumph, his next-door neighbor didn't even know the game was going on. Had no idea of the two teams playing. And so that fame and that fortune that he felt like he experienced was absolutely not even recognized by the person next door to him. Last but certainly not least, there was a possession that people came to in order to watch the parade on Thursday. We had a parade here. You know, twice a year we have traffic jams. They're called parades, okay, in Blackshear, Georgia, okay? Really, we have more when the train comes by. That causes a traffic jam too, okay? But we have an overpass for that. Anyway, we got two traffic jams. A parade was this past Thursday. And somebody's pride and joy, their possession, their child was in that parade, and that was the whole reason why they decided to get in that chaos and be a part of that traffic jam and sit waiting for just 20 seconds to see their loved one, because that was their pride possession riding in that play and for in that parade. For some of them, I know of one guy personally who he was elated because his daughter was able to be recognized by our student body and she was riding in that parade. However, not the entire community of Pierce County was joining in his excitement. Okay? Most people were not there. Because for most people, That isn't their pride and joy, someone else's child, okay? And that's a great tip for all of us parents. Not everybody thinks our kid's pretty, amen? You got me? And so not everybody's going to show up. Now, seriously, you need to get that perspective, okay? Not everybody thinks your kid's cute, all right? I mean, it's just, they lie to you, oh, it's cute. No, they're just making you feel good, all right? So not everybody showed up at the parade to watch your precious little baby ride on the parade. So the fame was futile. That moment of joy and pride was futile. It had limitations to it. But the reality is, folks, those are the worlds that we live in. We all have our little movies going on where we're the main character. Chris does it. It's called A Day in the Life and the Dimes of Chris Roberts. Starring Chris. Supporting actresses, his wife, Cammie. His two boys, Kellen and Joshua. And if you're honest with yourself, you live in that operation yourself. Movie Chris or movie whoever it is, you understand? And you have this little world mindset that you're in a movie where you're the main character. Today, you're the main character and you came to worship because you want everybody to know in your movie that you love Jesus. So that's why you're here today. But the backdrop is still Jesus and everybody else. The main event and stage is you. And we live in this mindset. We all do it, okay? We all, at some point or another, have this subconscious mindset that the world revolves around us and what we're doing and how we're relating to things. And so I give you those scenarios to just remind you of the futility and the limitations of that movie. Okay? Not everybody's noticing. Not everybody's chimed in. And they don't see the level the way you do it. That's my intro going into today's study. Because today I pray that we see through God's Word in Micah chapter 4, verses 6 through 13, a much bigger movie that's been taking place. A much bigger theme than the ones you and I can conjure up. One that's not about really us as the main event at all. In fact, if we just get to be a scene in the movie, that would be a glorious moment, you know, just to be a part of it. Okay? So let's look at that. Chapter 4 of Micah, verses 6 through 13. Please stand with me as we honor the reading of the Word of God. On that day, this is the Lord's declaration. I will assemble the lame and gather them scattered, those I have injured. I will make the lame into a remnant, those far removed into a strong nation. Then the Lord will rule over them in Mount Zion from this time on and forever. And you, watchtower for the flock, fortified hill of daughter Zion, the former rule will come to you. Sovereignty will come to daughter Jerusalem. Now why are you shouting loudly? Is there no king with you? Has your counselor perished so that the anguish grips you like a woman in labor? Wreathe and cry out, daughter Zion, like a woman in labor, for now you will leave the city and camp in the open fields. You will go to Babylon, and there you will be rescued. There the Lord will redeem you from the power of your enemies. Many nations have now assembled against you. They say, let her be defiled, and let us feast our eyes on Zion. Verse 12, but they do not know the Lord's intentions or understand his plan, that he has gathered them like sheaves to the threshing floor. Rise and thresh, daughter Zion, for I will make your horns iron and your hooves bronze so that you can crush many peoples. Then you will set apart their plunder to the Lord for destruction, their wealth to the Lord of all the earth. Let's pray. Father, now as we study your word, God, please guide us through your spirit. God, we don't take that for granted that we need your spirit in every moment to be able to be touched by a revelation and truth of what you're trying to say. So Holy Spirit, I do pray that you will speak to your people today. And God, if there is someone with us here today that is lost, that don't know you as their Lord and Savior, or think they do, but they really are outside of that relationship, Holy Spirit, I pray that you will help them see their need for you. And God, we just pray that you'll just bless this time as we study your word. We love you. Amen. All right, verse 6. says, on that day, this is the Lord's declaration. I will assemble the lame and gather the scattered, those I have injured. I will make the lame into a remnant, those far removed, into a strong nation. The Lord will rule over them in Mount Zion from this time on and forever. And you, watchtower for the flock, fortified hill of daughter Zion, the former rule will come to you. Sovereignty will come to the daughter of Jerusalem. These three verses picked up where we left off last week. Micah's still in a revelation from God about the end of times, the last days. Okay? And although different scholars who know God's word a whole lot better than I do would have different opinions about the timing and the order of these last days, we can rest assured that Micah has a revelation from God about the last days. And we pointed out just from Bible application that, hey guys, Revelation is not the only book of the Bible that speaks on the last days, okay? God's word speaks about it in other books of the Bible, and we get a glimpse of it here in Micah. So Micah 1 through 8 is speaking about the last days. And last week, what we saw from the last days in the first five verses is that God was going to come and establish peace and order again. That God was going to bring His peace. And we learned from that application that, hey, all through history that we've been privy to learn and study, there's never been peace on earth to everybody at the same time. Never has. And God's word is showing us quite clearly that, hey, there is going to be a day, because Michael goes into it and says, hey, those of you that have a spear and those of you that have a sword, you're going to turn those into different farm equipment, basically, or another purpose, because you're not going to need them for war anymore. And a man that has a grapevine or a tree that he owns, he's going to be able to lay underneath that grapevine or that tree and rest and not worry about someone coming behind him to attack him, because there's going to be a land of peace. And so we got this application last week that peace will never happen in this world until Jesus Christ is the center of it and He's established it. Okay? So the whole notion that we in our human effort with all our organizations or all those religions that say, hey, if we'll quit talking about our religion and all come as one, we can establish peace. Folks, there'll never be peace without Jesus. Jesus is the center of all peace. He's the foundation of it. And then that went into a deeper application. If the kingdom of heaven now lives within us, we have the ability personally in the ministry that God gives us every day with our family, our coworker, or the stranger that we meet, we have the opportunity to declare peace. We're the only ones that can offer true peace because we have Jesus Christ's presence through His Holy Spirit living in us. So it was a challenge to that. But the neat thing, what Micah is saying, there's going to be a day that everybody recognizes this peace, and it'll be here. Now, there'll be some outside of this peace. I don't want you to think that God has just all of a sudden miraculously saved everybody. No, He's in the process of judging and separating those that will not be a part of the kingdom in the last days. There is a separation in the last days from those who are of God and who are not. So please don't get this mindset that Jesus' love wins out over all and that everybody experiences That is not truth. There are those that will fall away because they have not surrendered to the lordship of Jesus Christ. In the last days, we'll separate those. But those that are found in Jesus Christ, in the last days, there's going to be a physical representation of peace. Who and how and when, that's up to deeper study. But the main application is that, hey, Jesus will establish it. Jesus is the center of it. That then goes into verse 5 where Micah says, man, who are you going to choose? You know, other gods? I'm going to choose Yahweh. He's my God. He's my deliverer. He has been revealed truth. He sees the truth, and he embraces that truth and says, I will serve no other than the great Yahweh, the one true God. That then leads into verses 6 through 8 that we just read. And in verse 6, he says, on that day, the Lord's declaration, I will assemble the lame and gather the scattered, those I have injured. I will make the lame into a remnant, those far from removed into a strong nation. The Lord will rule. And in the latter part of verse 8, the sovereignty will come to the daughter of Jerusalem. Basically, what is this implying and sharing? This is implying what Romans 11 says, that there will be a restoration, okay, to Israel. Now, how that will look, folks, is still going to fall under the banner of Jesus Christ and the lordship of Jesus. Okay? But there is going to be a restoration to all nations. To all nations. There is going to be a remnant pulled from all nations. And God's going to restore those people. And so here, verses 6 through 8 just signify here that, hey, even God's people, this chosen race, Israel, there is going to be a remnant from Israel that will be restored as well. And so that's established in this. Why did I wait till this week to talk to you about it? Well, one, we ran out of time last week, okay? The second, I think it goes to a bigger, deeper point that we need to study. Our goal here today is not walking out of here to get the proper order of the last days, although that's important. I'm currently trying to study that. I've got a good brother, you know, who's going to pick my brain, hopefully in a few weeks, about it. It's important to know about the last days, okay? But it's more important that when we read God's word, we walk away knowing more about the character of God and who he is and what he's about, okay, and what he's doing. And so I want you to, as a pastor today, I want us to land in these first three verses. I want to land right there in verse 6. On that day, this is the Lord's declaration, I will assemble the lame and gather the scattered, those I have injured. Did you notice that? I will bring back the lame and those that have been scattered, those I have injured. That's God doing the breaking. That's God causing the injury. God is saying, I will bring my lame, those that I have scattered, I will bring them back. I will do this. I have injured them. I believe this verse speaks to several verses about the discipline and deliverance of God and his people. And if you're writing notes, this will be my first point to give you today. It is for the sake of his name, or if you want to say it is for his glory, that God disciplines and delivers his people. It is for the glory of God, and it is for the purpose of the glory of God that he disciplines and delivers his people. What he is doing here in those days of contemporary time of Micah's day is that the nation of Israel was walking away from God. They had already been separated into two countries, and Judah, who Micah is speaking to, has walked away from God. And God is about to bring his discipline, but he's also reassuring of his deliverance. But we need to understand the purpose of the shepherd. We need to understand the purpose of why he does it. Folks, the reason why God disciplines and the reason why God delivers his people is for his glory. Okay? Now let's look at two other passages. There's plenty of them, but let's just look at two passages that hit on the discipline and the deliverance of God. I think we're going to first see the deliverance of God. Go to Psalms 106, if it's on the screen, scriptures I've given, 106, verse 6. Both we and our fathers have sinned. We have gone astray and have acted wickedly. Our fathers in Egypt did not grasp the significance of your wonderful works, or remember your many acts of faithful love. Instead, they rebelled by the Red Sea. Stay right there, guys. Our fathers in Egypt did not grasp the significance of your wonderful works, or remember your many acts of faithful love. Instead, they rebelled by the sea, the Red Sea. That's not in my notes. This is something we caught when we were just looking at the verse right here. Folks, steps that lead towards sin and rebellion begin when we take our focus off the wonderful work of God and the love he's shown to you and I. Our rebellion begins there. Folks, the priority of the church is worship. God doesn't need you. He wants you to love him back. He wants you to worship him. He doesn't need your worship. He invites you to worship him because he's worthy of worship. But starting all the way back to Adam and Eve, think about the fall, the destruction, the choice of grabbing the fruit, if they had reflected on the wonderful works of God, if they had reflected on the faithful love of God, they'd have said, you know what? This guy's created this whole thing in about 5 days. There's probably a very good, you know, reason why he established don't eat from this tree, okay? And number two, God's not out to get one up on me as far as manipulate me. So Satan, you know what? I still think he has my best interest at heart. I'm not going to take from it. But they forgot the faithful works of God. And they forgot the faithful love of God. And they rebelled. Folks, our rebellion always begins at a trust factor with God. If you're living in opposition of God's will and God's perfect order, it comes down to the fact that there is something that you just don't trust. You don't trust his design plan and his incredible works, how he made things, or you don't trust that he loves you. But it always comes down to one or the other, because our rebellion comes from that truth. That's not the point where we're wanting to get at. Look at verse 8. That's the point. Look at it. Yet he saved them because of his name, to make his power known. He rebuked the Red Sea. He led them through the depths as through a desert. He saved them from the land of the adversary. He redeemed them from the hand of the enemy. Water covered their foes. Not one of them remained. Then they believed his promises and sang his praises. Verse 8, it's because of his great name that he saves us. And because he intervenes, why? Because of his great name. Because what is the byproduct? What's the end result? What is the final result of when God intervenes in our life to save us from ourselves? When he steps in for his great name, why? Because in the end result, we start bragging about his name. We start singing his praises. We start saying, hallelujah, Ric Flair moments. This is incredible. Awesome. Woohoo! And we sing. And we praise him. We worship God again. Friends, do you not understand the gospel? The gospel message of this, that you are the one creation that he created to have a special relationship with, so that you could understand what he meant when he said, I love you. And you would understand how to say back to him, I love you. We were the one creation he created for that. But yet we forgot his wonderful works. And we forgot his unfaithful love. And we rebelled, and it brought sin into our life. Judgment and wrath were for our purpose then. We deserved it. But God comes back and he chooses mercy and grace through the cry of a baby born of a virgin who rises up 33 years later, not only delivers and shows us truth again in God in his 3-year ministry, but then this same Jesus, God's one and only Son, climbs on a cross for you and me, takes the wrath of God for our sins, intercepts our judgment, buries it to the grave, rises again 3 days later so that he could have victory over sin and death and all its power. Then 40 days later, after being witnessed by 500 witnesses, he goes back up to heaven. And he sits at the right hand of God, waiting to return. But in the meantime, sends the Spirit of God into those who cry out in faith to Jesus as Lord. So that they can do what? Sing his praises again. Isn't that awesome? And why sing his praises again? So every part of creation, not there just be a gap so that Satan can say, hey, you're not perfect, you're not holy, God. There's one piece of creation that won't worship you. Know that even mankind who rejected, he could bought and pay for their ransom so that they once again could turn around and say, you are awesome, God. He delivers for his name's sake. Number two, we see this in Proverbs chapter 3. He disciplines for his name's sake. Look at this in Proverbs 3, verse 11. Do not despise the Lord's instruction, my son, and do not loathe his discipline. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves, just as a father, the son he delights in. Happy is the man who finds wisdom and who acquires understanding. For she is more profitable than silver, and her revenue is better than gold. That's talking about wisdom. Wisdom is more precious than jewels. Nothing you desire compares with wisdom. Long life is in wisdom's right hand, and his left hand riches and honor. Wisdom's ways are pleasant, and all her paths peaceful. She is a tree of life to those who embrace her. Those who hold on to her are happy. The Lord founded the earth by wisdom and established the heavens by understanding. By his knowledge, the watery depths broke open and the clouds dripped with dew. I mean, why does Jesus always keep talking about this stuff? Y'all know this? I mean, how many chapters we got to read in the Bible where he's talking about what he created? There must be a point to it. He wants us to join in the repetition and the greatness. And don't say that gets boring. You say go dogs all the time when you go to an Athens game. All right? It's repetitive for a reason. Keep going. Maintain your competence and discretion, my son. Don't lose sight of them. There will be a life for you, an adornment for your neck. Then you will go safely on your way. Your foot will not stumble. When you lie down, you will not be afraid. When you lie down, and your sleep will be pleasant. We can stop right there. Don't you want to experience that? Don't you want to lay down and your life be at peace? No fear of anything because you're at peace? Where do they find that from? They find it from wisdom. Where does wisdom come from? From the Lord. That's why the guy writing Proverbs 3 says, son, don't hate discipline. Don't run from it. Because if we receive discipline, the byproduct of receiving that discipline comes wisdom. And wisdom is a gift from God for the betterment of you, to help you. And wisdom is Jesus. After discipline comes wisdom. You don't believe me? Ask a cow trying to walk through an electric fence, okay? And they will have wisdom after that experience. Ask a dog that we're trying to train so that they won't, so we're animal lovers, so that they won't run out in the highway and kill themselves, okay, by a car. We put an electrical shock on their collar and neck. Why? Not because we take pride and joy in them getting zapped. It's because we love that animal and we don't want them running onto the street and getting hit and run over. We create a discipline. After discipline comes wisdom. So truth number one that I wanted you to grab from Micah 4, 6 through 8. When don't lose those words. I will gather back those I have scattered that I have injured. God uses discipline and God uses deliverance for his glory. We're going to camp out there a little longer. This is where I want to say this to you. Number one, an application of humility. Remember the gospel. He didn't deliver you because you started out good. And he's like, oh man, if we don't get that back, we're really going to lose something. That wasn't the case. He delivered you so that when people saw your life headed this way, which was nowhere, full of despair, destruction, and hurt, that when God intercepted your life, they would see a dramatic difference of saying, where's the peace coming from? Where's the joy coming from? Where's the satisfaction? And they wouldn't be able to say, oh, I just had a good day and started working real hard at it. All they'll be able to say is, man, God's working in my life. People say, wow, I want to know that God. It's for his namesake that he does it. And remember this about the discipline. Friends, it's the Lord that disciplines. Not us. And there's two sides of that coin. Not taking things in our own strength and becoming like the Pharisees, where Jesus rebuked him and said, who are you to put these extra burdens on the people? Things that you can't even live up to. And he was applying to the law that they were making according to the law. All these other applications. God had already written his law. It was perfect. He didn't need any other help with it. But the Pharisees tried to add some application to it. You got to do this, this, and this. And Jesus said, you hypocrites. You clean the outside of the cup, but the inside is dirty. Be careful that we don't do that. But secondly, to the enablers in the room, get out of God's way when he's trying to get a hold of one of his children. The father of the prodigal son was not at the pig trough when the guy came to his senses. Quit getting into the way of what God's trying to do in a loved one's life. He loves them more than you. And he will get to their attention. But a lot of times we don't trust that he loves them like we love them. You're right, he doesn't. He loves them more. And it's not in your power anyway. Get out of the way. Quit enabling them. For God disciplines and delivers those he loves. Okay? It's not your job. God doesn't need your help. He may invite you to be a part of a task, but be very careful that be sure that that's God speaking to us, be a part of that, okay? All right. Let's move forward. We're out of the revelation of the last days at this moment, and something comes back to them in verse 9. Micah, I believe, is addressing something in their day and time. Verse 9 says, now why are you shouting loudly? Is there no king with you? Has your counselor perished so that the anguish grips you like a woman in labor? Wreath and cry out, daughter Zion, like a woman in labor, for now you will leave the city and camp in the open fields. You will go to Babylon. There you will be rescued. There the Lord will redeem you from the power of your enemies. During Micah's days, there was threats of Israel being taken over at that time. Not by Babylon necessarily, but by other kingdoms. And so there was some things to be in despair. So many would say that, hey, this is not, again, in the last days, but currently this was relevant. They were in despair. They were concerned about being run over or taken advantage of, again. And so Micah speaks to him and says, why are you shouting loudly? Why are you without a king who can rule you or lead you? Why do you feel like you're in this detriment? You are, but I got some good news for you. For now you will leave the city and camp in the open fields. You will go to Babylon, and there you will be rescued. There the Lord will redeem you from the power of your enemies. Now, if we're not careful here, we miss what Micah is trying to say. This would almost be like those problem proclaimers in our life, you got me? With unrealistic solutions of how this is going to be solved. You're stranded on the side of the road and your engine is dead. It's not coming back to life. Someone comes up to you and says, well, I guess you're ready for that new car. Is that your excitement in that moment? No, okay? You're not excited at all. You actually look at that person and says, what does that have to do with the problem at hand, okay? I can't get to where I'm going. If we're not careful, we look at this scripture in Micah, these people that are currently in some distress, and Micah comes to him and says, hey, I got good news. You're going to be taken out of this city. And you're going to go to another land. But God's going to come back and take you back. And have destruction on his enemies. I don't think you are quite getting the point here yet. Let's go to Jeremiah 29, okay? Let's fast forward now, okay? I would say we're fast forwarding maybe, I might be a couple of decades off, but you'll get why we can have that room to be wrong on that. We're maybe talking 140 years away from now, okay? 140 years away, if we look at Kings and Chronicles of all the kings that succeeded and how many years they reigned. Micah says, hey, you're one day going to be taken to Babylon, but then God's going to come and get you back. So we're around the ballpark, a couple of decades off, either way. of about 140 years later, let's look at what Jeremiah says in 29. For this is what the Lord says, when 70 years for Babylon are complete, I'll attend to you and will confirm my promise concerning you to restore you to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, this is the Lord's declaration, plans for your welfare, not for your disaster, to give you a future and a hope. You will call to me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. I will be found by you, this is the Lord's declaration, and I will restore your fortune and gather you from all the nations and places where I banished you. This is the Lord's declaration. I'll restore you the place I deported you from. Okay? Micah speaks of this. Jeremiah is now living in it. The people are in Babylon, and he's saying, hey, go back to verse 10. When 70 years are up, God will come and confirm his promise concerning you to restore you to this place. Verse 11. For I know the plans I have for you, plans for your welfare, not for your disaster, to give you a future and a hope. For decades now, the American church has wrongly taken one verse out of context to make it one of their top 10 verses of all 9. For I know the plans you have for me, God. Plans to give me a hope and a future. And we pray that in an immediate context. Now, I'm not saying you're wrong. You need to walk out of here saying, I'm a terrible Christian. I'm a stupid Christian, yada, yada. You know, I'm not saying that. All right, I've done it plenty of times. But in a lot of scripture, let's look at this verse in context. I know the plans you have for me. Plans to prosper, not to harm me. Plans to give me a hope and a future. Let's put it in the context of what it was written in. Okay? Jeremiah speaks to a people. And folks, we're not living in the patriarch's days where you live for 200, 300, 400 years. Okay? We're living in real life time now, you know, of what we would call a normal life. So Jeremiah, what if he walks up to us today and says to all of us, and we're in captivity, got some great news for you. God is coming back. After 70 years, he's going to deliver you. Because he knows the plans he has for you. Plans not to harm you, but to protect you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. How many of you in this room are going to be around 70 years from now? Maybe the little ones that we're holding in our arms right now. But I can guarantee you they're not going to be in the prime of their life in that moment. They're not going to be doing cartwheels, okay? When God comes back, it's not going to be physically capable. Because they're going to be old at that time. All right. Now y'all are thinking. So if we're not talking about my immediate context, we're talking about a bigger thing. Chris, 70 years from now, I'm not going to be around, but God says this is still a plan for me. This is still a hope for me. This is still a restoration for me. Here's the next point, folks, that I want you to grasp. Oh, before we get there, let's go to 31. We've got to see this. Before you get to 31, I believe it's in chapter 30, verse 26. It might be 31, 26. But Jeremiah has this revelation from God, and it says he wakes up from a pleasant night's sleep. So this vision that's all-encompassing is just blessing his heart. So he says this in verse 31. Look, the days are coming. This is the Lord's declaration when I make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. This one will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant they broke even though I had married them, the Lord's declaration. Instead, this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days. The Lord's declaration. I will put my law within them and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. No longer will one teach his neighbor or his brother saying, know the Lord, for they will all know me, from the least to the greatest of them. This is the Lord's declaration, for I will forgive their wrongdoing and never again remember their sin. How in the world in Jeremiah 29 verse 13 am I going to seek God with all my heart if I've got an evil heart? How is this going to be prosperous and a plan for me if I'm going to be an evil heart still? Chapter 31, because God's going to give you a new heart. God's going to write on your heart His laws and His ways, and you're not going to have to be taught by someone else. Like a prophet, the Holy Spirit is going to speak into your heart, and you're going to have an old walk with Him. So what is the plan, church? What is the glorious future? Jeremiah is speaking about the gospel that we have been saturated with. He's speaking about eternal life that we have in God now. And this is the issue of the church today. If we are going to be a people that live for the glory of God, then our focus has to be off a life for right now. Our focus has to be on a greater life than the one we're living. Our focus must be on a life that was before we began. Our focus must be on a life while we're here that's sustaining us. And our focus must be on a life that will be beyond our time. That is only when we start breaking into the first steps of living for the glory of God. Is when it goes beyond your own life and is wrapped up in a bigger life than yours. Jeremiah is not insane here, given a wrong timing of a word coming out of his mouth and saying, hey, 70 years from now, God's going to take you out of here. He knows that they're not going to be there. But his focus isn't on the here and now, folks. His focus is on a greater, bigger, sovereign plan that's going on right now with us individually. It's about the work and the activity of the Almighty God, restoring His glorious name. And He is saying, hey guys, you're going to get to be a part of that. I'm choosing to make you a part of that. And truth number two, to live for the glory of God, we must embrace a bigger life than ours. We must embrace the life that was before we began, that sustains us while we're here, and goes on far beyond after we're gone. And the only one that does that is the uncreated, the one true God, Yahweh. We know Him and His Son, Jesus. We have a personal relationship through Jesus. Ministry leaders, how can you evaluate and test yourself to see if you're living for the glory of God? Do you long and burn for the ministry that God's allowed you to be a part of, to continue to be going beyond your time? Do you rejoice when you can see the opportunity of it existing far greater than what you were ever a part of? Do you embrace with humility what God was already doing before He invited you to be a part of it? That's when we start living for the glory of God. That's when we start making a little me almost to the no existence. Oh, I wish that the church would long for the glory of God again. Maybe then in our community we wouldn't have complacent Christians who are grandparents now, who remember the days that their kids walked an aisle but see no fruit in their life right now, claiming onto that fact that they're a member of the church, although they haven't darkened the doors of that church in weeks or months. And their grandkids are going to hell. As they long and pine for retirement age of living out their glory for their moment, that no one else will join in the parade or the shout or the honor of that. There are generations coming behind them that will adopt and inherit their curses because they've not allowed the grace of God to come pour into their life, into the lives of those that they were called to disciple. Why? Because they're not living for the glory of God. They live for the glory of a church. They live for the glory of themselves. They live the glory for the times that they were doing ministry, but they don't live for the glory of God now. The glory that was before they began. The glory that is way beyond them. Folks, we're not even beginning to start living for the glory of God until we get beyond our own life. And you wonder why our country is in the sad shape it is, because the glory of God hasn't been magnified in God's people in decades. There'll be 10 times more sermons on practical, self-absorbed ways of living this life here on earth to make it more relevant for you than there are sermons about the glory of God and living for the glory of God. Our motives and decisions that we make, even in this own election, the reasons that you are choosing the candidates that you are, possibly be skewed because you are not living for the glory of God in that moment and basing your faith on what am I going to do in this election. If it's for the glory of God, it may be extremely different than what you think. God has not called us to live for the Republican Party. God has not called us to live for the Democratic Party. God has not called us to live for the approval of mankind, even in our own pews. God has called us to live for His glory. You have been adopted by the grace of God to be a part of a life bigger than your own. Now join that. Micah is not irrelevant to his day and time. He's trying to make relevance of his day and time and say, there's something bigger than you and I. Be a part of that. Rejoice in that. Let's keep going. Verse 11. Many nations have now assembled against you. They say, let her be defiled, and let us feast our eyes on Zion. But they do not know the Lord's intentions or understand His plan, that He has gathered them like sheaves to the threshing floor. Micah is again speaking, saying, hey, your enemies around you, they're crawling, and they can't wait to say, man, we're going to tear your eyes out. We're going to destroy you. Look what we're going to do to Israel. But verse 12, Micah says, hold on. They don't realize that God's basically laughing at them. They're basically coming apart of God's grand plan of what He's doing. Verse 12, but they don't know the Lord's intentions or understand His plan, that He has gathered them like sheaves to the threshing floor. God's setting a trap for them. God's doing this. Let's look at some verses that focus on this, okay? Let's look at Psalms 33. Okay, good deal. The heavens were made by the word of the Lord, and all the stars by the breath of His mouth. There he goes bragging again. Same old thing. Look at what He's created. Well, there's some theme or something. Okay, verse 7. He gathers the waters of the sea in a heap. He puts the depths in storehouses. Let the whole earth tremble before the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of Him. For He spoke and it came into being. How about that? He commanded and it came into existence. The Lord frustrates the counsel of the nations. He thwarts the plans of the peoples. The counsel of the Lord stands forever. The plans of His heart from generation to generation. Happy is the nation whose God is Lord, the people who have chosen to be His own possession. The Lord looks down from heaven. He observes everyone. He gazes on all the inhabitants of the earth from His dwelling place. He alone shapes their hearts. He considers all their works. A king is not saved by a large army. A warrior will not be delivered by a great strength. The horse is a false hope for safety. It provides no escape by its great power. Now the eye of the Lord is on those who fear Him, those who depend on His faithful love, to deliver them from death and to keep them alive in famine. We wait for You, Yahweh. He is our help and our shield. For our hearts rejoice in Him because we trust in His holy name. May Your faithful love rest on us, Yahweh, for we put our hope in You. Wow. What if we submerged ourselves with these truths every morning? The greatness of our God. Micah says to his people, and it's matched up by the character of God in Psalms. The enemies prowl around to you. They want to tear your eyes out, basically. But they don't know the plans of the Lord. They don't know that they're set up for a trap. Verse 11 of Psalm 33. Verse 10 says, he disrupts the plans of the people. Verse 11 says that his plans, look at verse 11. Psalms 33, verse 11. But his plans are from generation to generation. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart from generation to generation. Nothing stops him, guys. Nothing stops the will of God. Nothing stops his plan. Point number one. For his name's sake, the Lord disciplines and delivers. Point number two, to live for the glory of God, we have to embrace a bigger life than our own. And the only life worth embracing is the one that's been there before yours, the one that sustains yours, and the one that will live after yours. Point number three, the one that lives for the glory of God is not distracted by the enemy's plans. The one that lives for the glory of God is not distracted or derailed, you put whatever word you want to put in there, by the plans of God. Now, I'm not saying that we won't take notice of the enemy's plans. I'm not saying that we'll be naive of the enemy's plans because we're focused on the glory of God. What I mean is that our heart will not get to the point of losing our faith. We will persevere and continue to worship and proclaim his name, because when you live for the glory of God, nothing the enemy throws your way will derail the plan of God. And that's what your focus is on. Because the Lord's plans last for generations to generations, right? That's what Micah's saying to the people. Hey, Lord's got this. All these enemies coming against you, God's just setting them up for a trap. Application can be in many ways. I'm sure there are many battles that are going on in this room today in your life. If you will choose to put your faith and your hope in a life beyond your own, if you will heed the discipline of God, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 11, heed the discipline of God. You know what comes before verse 11? Romans 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Some of the screw-ups and the mess-ups and the storms you may be in is because you have walked away from the infallible word of God. The word of God will never fail you. It will not disappoint you. It is not something to retreat from. It is something to surrender and submit to. And some of the storms in your life may be because you have walked away from what the truth of God. You have leaned on your own understanding, your experience or your exposure, or just what feels right or makes sense. But the word of God says lean not on your own understanding. The word of God also says in Proverbs, because the heart can deceive you. Your worst enemy is yourself, my friend. Heed to the discipline of God because it brings forth wisdom. Wisdom for your benefit. But truth number three. Is, are we going to be a people that live for the glory of God? Because if we are, we're not distracted. And so there might be many battles, but I want to bring up this election, an application for all of you on this election. Don't know who you're voting for or if you're voting at all. God's glory and whether or not Jesus is going to be on his throne will not be determined by the outcome of this election. And the Church of America better get a grip. Because your attitude and your actions leading up to this election are not showing possibly that God is on his throne. You're putting your hope in one man or one woman, or you're just backing out completely. And I'm not saying that any of those three are the wrong approach, but the motive of your heart may be. The motive of why you're doing what you're doing. You see, because God has called you to embrace a life bigger than the one you're living in right now. And there will be a man or woman in our office at the beginning of the new year who truly doesn't just represent themselves. They're going to represent a bunch of ideals from the thousands of people that have got them to that point. And I am not saying at all not to be concerned about the state of where our nation is. Church, I just want to implore you and encourage you on this. This thing is wrecking people's world. Stock market is going to go one way or the other based on who's elected. Congressmen and lobbyists, are you going to have a great day or a bad day? People are going to either be able to sit at the family table and talk or not talk based on this. Jobs may be impacted. Supreme Court justices elected over the next 4 years may dictate the already inward state of where the heart of this nation is. Y'all get that? It's not those guys' fault. They're just a reflection of what's already in the heart of the nation of America. Okay? That's where it is. All this is going on. And all this can be unsettling for someone who's living for their life. But you are the salt and light of the earth. You are the ones that have been rescued from the darkness. You are the ones that have been brought into a greater light, the true light. A light that brings life to all men. And that life is the only way to God. And that life is far greater than the life you exist in. It was before you were around. It sustains you right now. And it will be beyond you in the future. And church, if we're living for the glory of God, then a lost world that's in despair over a futile matter in the eyes of other worlds, other countries in this world, but those that are living in real life despair over it should be able to find hope in God's people, the church. That we are not flustered, that we are not shaken, because we don't live for this day, we live for a day to come. And if we're living for the glory of God, that's what needs to be seen. That is the banner that needs to be raised. That is the sign that needs to be in the yard. That needs to be the bumper sticker on your car. There's got to be something of more substance than this election. People are needing that. We're the only ones that God's left here on earth to give that. And that's only going to happen if you're living in the glory of God and you're living for a life beyond yourself. Okay? Your opinions and convictions, I pray they're biblical. I pray your actions towards this election are found in faith according to guidance of God's word. I pray that you will sense the Holy Spirit's leadership and get it affirmed by the word of God. But at the end of the day, may what people see on the outside is their deeper hope in a God who is king on his throne than a particular man or woman that's in the Oval Office. Amen? Live in that, because that's what will set you apart. That'll be what makes you taste different. That'll be what makes you look different in this pagan culture that we live in. This pagan culture that exists in the Democratic and Republican parties. This pagan culture that exists in the nonpartisan parties. God has allowed you for this time to be a part of His movie scene and show His glory. So let's do it. Verse 13, rise and thresh, daughter Zion, for I will make your horns iron and your hooves bronze, so you can crush many peoples. Then you will set apart their plunder to the Lord for destruction, their wealth to the Lord of all the earth. Micah then goes in this chant of what he sees in the future, that God is going to replace His people, not with slavery and chains, but is going to give them the power to unite together for the glory of God and to lead a sweeping army declaring His glory to the nations. Best way I know to wrap up with that is the last chapter in the Bible. Turn with me in Revelation 22. Here it is on the screen. Then He showed me the river of living water, sparkling like crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb. Down the middle of the broad street of the city, the tree of life was on both sides of the river, bearing 22 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree are for healing the nations. And there will no longer be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and His slaves will serve Him. They will see His face, and His name will be on their foreheads. Night will no longer exist, and people will not need lamplight or sunlight, because the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever. Then He said to me, these words are faithful and true, and the Lord, the God of spirits of the prophets, has sent His angel to show His slaves what must quickly take place. Look, I am coming quickly. The one who keeps the prophetic words of the book is blessed. I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things. When I heard and saw them, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who had shown them to me. But he said to me, don't do that. I'm a fellow slave with you, your brothers and the prophets, and those who keep the words of this book. Worship God. What a theme. What a theme. Keep going. He also said to me, don't seal the prophetic words of this book, because the time is near. Let the unrighteous go on in his unrighteousness. Let the filthy go on being made filthy. Let the righteous go on in righteousness, and let the holy go on being made holy. Look, I am coming quickly, says Jesus, and my reward is with me to repay each person according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter the city by the gates. Outside are the dogs, the sorcerers, the sexually immoral, the murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices lying. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to attest these things to you for the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright morning star. Both the Spirit and the bride say, come. Anyone who hears should say, come, and the one who is thirsty should come. Whoever desires should take the living water as a gift. I testify to everyone who hears the prophetic words of this book. If anyone adds to them, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And if anyone takes away from the words of this prophetic book, God will take away his share of the tree of life and the holy city written in this book. He who testifies about these things says, yes, I am coming quickly. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with all the saints. Amen. Don't know what's around the corner, guys, for our country and our nation. But I pray you hear the words from our brothers and sisters up in heaven. Based on whoever we have as a president, neither one loved the Lord. Therefore, their actions will somehow show in that. Regardless, what do we do? Can we still love God in the midst of a pagan country? Listen to Daniel speak from heaven saying, yes, I did. Continue to worship God. What do we do when our culture wants us to bow down to other gods of worship? What will we do in that moment? Can we still stand for God? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego will say, yes, you can still stand for God. What do you do if persecution comes our way? A trice in our faith and our religious liberty is taken. What do we do then? Then we say, come, Lord Jesus. We wait upon you and not this world like John did in Revelation. Come, Lord Jesus, come. But regardless, we don't lose our hope. For our hope is not in this day. Our hope is in the day to come. And the world needs to see that, folks. Let that be the political sign in your yard this week. Let that be the bumper sticker that you drive around with. the hope of the one true King that reigns over all. Let's do our part in responding in obedience to what He calls us to do according to this election. But let's remember it's all a part of the glory of God. May we live in that. We're going to wrap up on this song. Band, come ahead and come up here. We're going to pray and close in our Bible study. I think it's a fitting song that y'all just sang earlier. I think it's a song that the church needs to walk out of here and hope again, singing this song of our one true God. Let's pray. Father, thank You for who You are. Thank You, Lord, that there is none like You and that You are in control of all things. May we be a people that live in that hope. We ask this, Jesus, in Your name. Amen.